A warm welcome to the last Trade and Development Symposium E15 panel, focusing on the topic of foreign direct investment and particularly investment policy. My name is Cristian Rodriguez Schiffel. I'm with the World Economic Forum Trade and Investment Practice. Together with my team and here my ICTSD colleagues, we're very happy to have contributed to shape the E15 initiative, and it's very gratifying to see how the E15 is already delivering innovative thoughts here at the TDS, and we hope to keep doing so in Davos at our launch and going forward next year. I'm particularly excited to be here moderating this panel titled "The End of the North-South Game: Foreign Direct Investment in the 21st Century." On that note, I'm going to start introducing our distinguished panelists. And first, we have Director General Martin van den Berg. Martin is the Director General for Foreign Economic Relations of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of the Kingdom of the Netherlands. At the far end, we have with us Ana Escobedo. Ana is the Director of International Government Affairs of ArcelorMittal. Following Ana, we have Mr. Moses Ikara. Dr. Ikara is the Managing Director of the Kenya Investment Authority, KenInvest. Following at the left of Martin, we have Dr. James Shan, the Director of Investment and Enterprise of UNCTAD, the United Nations Council of Trade and Trade and Development. Nicole Grignard joins us from the International Chamber of Commerce. She is the Manager of Trade and Investment Policy at the ICC. And finally, Georgios Altintzis is an Economic and Social Policy Officer at the International Trade and Union Confederation. So we're very, very fortunate to have very different constituents and views, affiliations here represented. I'll start with a brief overview of the topic. And as you're well aware, foreign direct investment is a primary vehicle to bring goods and services into foreign markets. FDI is definitely a key driver on the formation of global value chains, a topic that we have overly discussed this week at TDS. However, FDI, of course, operates hand-in-hand at these global value chains with trade, making at times the distinction between trade and investment a bit artificial. However, although the distinction is there, trade and investment regulation remain largely distinct. While trade rests on the foundation of the GATT and of the WTO agreements starting in 1947, no similar vehicle exists for foreign direct investment. What we have now in regulation is what we call a spaghetti bowl of around 3,000 plus in bilateral investment treaties and other kind of investment agreements, which are really very fragmented way of regulating the field on foreign investment. So before the speakers get into the substance and into where we're going to get into the current issues of FDI and investment policy and definitely in relationship with WTO, what I want to do is walk you into just a couple of minutes on the context and really to say how did we get here on this picture of, you know, 3,000 plus bilateral investment treaties and a regime which is very much in flux today. Starting in 1959, the response to this to the lack of multilateral investment disciplines was the creation of bilateral investment treaty, the BIT programs in several countries. The proliferation of BITs was marked by a very important innovation that we'll be discussing today here, which was that these BITs now had provisions that provided that the agreements were enforceable through a dispute settlement mechanism, which now allowed private actors to sue states before an international tribunal, what we call ISDS, investor-state dispute settlement. In particular, this has been performed by also an organization you'll be familiar to you, which is ICSID, the International Convention for Settlement of Investment Disputes since 1965. The first generation of BITs was primarily driven by the developed countries' desire to protect their investment in developing countries. The initial treaties all have the same pattern and actually gave title to this pattern, which is where North-South. So we have the initial Germany one with Pakistan, Netherlands here with Tunisia, the UK, Egypt, the US with Panama, and else. So it was definitely for a long time a North-South game. However, the 1990s really changed the game and brought an explosion of BIT negotiations. And just to picture that, since 1959, the first bit, Germany-Pakistan, until 1989, we had around 400 bits. I'm sure James knows the exact number. But then, since 1990 until 2005, so another 15 years, we had over 2,000. So the game completely changed. We had a fivefold growth on the negotiation of treaties. The other thing that happened is that we had two big new frameworks going on investment. The first, one of all, maybe surprisingly to some of you, comes from WTO and is the General Agreement of Trading Services, the GATS, which provided, of course, for Mode 3 commercial presence in a positivist approach, which is, of course, investment in services. And the second really big game changer was the NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement, which for the first time included investment within a broader free trade agreement, including provisions that provided market access on a negative list approach for investment. So what happened here with these two big innovations is that we're no longer talking about this old North-South games on only protection, but we now have added the investment liberalization angle, market access. And I think James and others will also be referring to that second important leg of investment policy, where I think it's a big opportunity of the future to talk about market access and creating more opportunities and not only focusing on the investor state dispute settlement. The other thing, and I'm tend to finish with that, it was that South-South agreement started to come into play. Investment no longer also ran north-south, but also a lot south-south. I come from Chile, for example, and quickly we turn into the biggest investors in Peru, in Argentina, and other countries, which was unprecedented before. And then also even started to flow from south to north, and we have here ArcelorMittal represented, who is, of course, come from mainly from Indian capitals that are investing a lot in developed countries. The attempts at multilateralism keep failing, not only the Havana Charter of the 40s, but then the multilateral agreement on investment from the OECD did not come to an end, and we all know very well that in 2004, that Singapore issues were dropped from the Doha Development Agenda, including investments. So what is the state of affairs today? We'll have the state of affairs, it's a regime in flux, very controversial, more than 500 plus known investor state dispute settlement cases, questions on the regime, and actually grassroots reactions not only in developing countries, but also in developed countries seeking to guarantee specific levels of policy space for country and questioning the investor state dispute settlement mechanism. And something that will be familiar to Martin here is that when the EU brought consultations on the ISDS mechanism of the TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade Investment Partnership, you receive, I believe, around 150,000 public comments. So that denotes really an interest that has been not heard of before. What's on the table now is to highlight the regime's need to address sustainable development concerns, and also I think the way into this new mega regional agreement, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, TTIP, but also things happening at other regions that are less looked, like here in Africa for the Continental Free Trade Area or others, will play into this regime going forward. So with that and with that small introduction, what I want to give you now is Director General Martin van den Berg, who is going to, I think, initially focus on the topics of this new EU strategy, or the trade for all strategy on investment, on trade and investment, and talk about some of the proposals such as the World Investment Court, the link with WTO, and of course, a little bit about this mega regional agreements, especially TTIP. So with that, Martin, please.
Christian, thank you very much. Thank you very much for the invitation. I think we are discussing here today a very important and also a very relevant issue, but also a very complicated issue, as you described, looking to the history of the debate on investment agreements and multilateral investment discussions. I think everybody knows we really need investment. We need investment for growth. We need it for infrastructure, education, health, energy, to adapt and to mitigate to the threat of climate change, and we need investment for the implementation of the SDGs. A second observation is that about what we see happening in value change. Value change driving private investments, increasing shares of the value of a product are added outside a country or region to which a country of completion belongs. And we see that through value change, trade and investment are increasingly connected as well. And global and regional value change can also act as a catalyst for development. So they are both very crucial for developing countries connect to globalization, and also FDI therefore plays a very important role in the development agenda as well. So it's good that we see that investment and FDI flows are continued to rise. And if you look 20 years back or 35 years back, global FDI flows are not flows among OECD countries, but really involve non-OECD countries, LDC, so it's really a global picture. And together with those growing FDI flows, we see also a growing concern and a heated public about regulations for international investment. If you look to the European debate on ISDS, I don't think anyone expected thousands of people demonstrating in several capitals in EU member states about TTIP, about ISDS. So there's a large public debate, which is, I think, a very good thing. And they illustrate the fundamental discussion on the investment dispute settlement, on the right of public authorities to regulate, or on exceptions for public policies or national security, or on the investment transparency regimes, on treaty shopping, the claim that treaties are used by shell or mailbox companies, also a discussion very much happening in the Netherlands, because we have a lot of bilateral investment treaties. This heated debate in Europe is on the one hand very much on the right of public authorities to regulate, and I think that's a very important and understandable discussion. But sometimes it seems that we forget that there is a basic objection of investment protection, and that basic objection still remains very valid. Very recently, we did in the Netherlands a study about bilateral investment treaties done by the CPB, an economic think tank in the Netherlands. And this study shows that bilateral investment treaties increase bilateral FDI stock on average 30%. Bilateral investment treaties are especially effective in upper middle income countries in East Asia and Central and Eastern Europe. And low income countries benefit from investment treaties, but not if these if these countries are located in Sub-Sahara or Latin America. So there we still see that geography still matters. But this study seems also to suggest that investment treaties are more effective when national law is weak. Understandable, of course. So the overall conclusion is that investment treaties are still effective in giving investment a boost. So discussions on investment regimes are therefore extremely relevant. And we see that those discussions are not only a discussion among OECD members, but it's really a global discussion. Also in developing countries, there is a pressing need for reforms in the global international investment agreements. So the question is not so much about whether we should reform, but about how and what to reform. And I think status quo is really not an option at the moment. And in the past, we had not very successful discussions on multilateral investment frameworks. So now we have a spaghetti bowl of over 3,600 bilateral investment agreements. And this highly fragmented system, to me, seems not very efficient. And it's not a very effective way of governing global investment flows. And there's also a growing dissatisfaction with the current international investment regime. So we also see a revival of discussions on multilateral investment approach. So we see a revival of discussions on multilateral investment approaches. And at the same time, a growing number of countries reviewing their and adapting their international investment policies. And that's what we see in the Netherlands, but also in the EU. Within Europe, we did a first step in the TTIP discussion. We proposed major changes in the ISDS. In the TTIP proposals, the EU has replaced the system of ad hoc tribunals with a new system of a public investment court system composed of a tribunal at first instance and an appeal tribunal operating like a traditional court. And there will be a clear code of conduct to avoid conflicts of interest, so we will have independent judges. So this is a major change, I think, coming from ISDS to a public court system. And in the longer run, the EU support the incorporation of investment rules into the WTO discussion. So in preparing this, I think we should be open for discussions on multilateral approaches. And I think several international organizations like the UNCTAD, very helpful and proposing very relevant suggestions for an agenda for reform. UNCTAD, OECD, World Bank, ICTSD, and also China made international investment a priority for the G20 agenda. And what issues should we put on the agenda for reform? I think very relevant is the balance between the right to regulate, investors' protection, and responsible business conduct, to balance the interest of a firm with the public interest of a country. We have to discuss the system of ad hoc arbitral tribunals, the transparency of an arbitration process. Do we see opportunities for an investment court globally? It's also on promoting and facilitating foreign investment, on the transparency of investment regimes. We understand that countries like to attract foreign investors, but we should avoid, I think, investment distortions or policies that lead to home country measure shopping. FDI in developing countries. Policies to attract FDI are not always policies to maximize the benefits of FDI. So how we make FDI more beneficial for the economy as a whole, and how we maximize spillover effects from FDI to local or regional economies. Many developing countries have their local content policies, and they are very understandable, but you can sometimes ask whether these policies are really very effective. How to ensure responsible investment? How to improve effectiveness of the OECD guidelines on responsible business conduct? Very relevant also. And how could we better embed investment policies with a broader reform agenda in countries? And finally, concerns about state-controlled entities. The question is whether the assistance given to state-controlled entities distorts the competitive outward FDI landscape. A very complicated, but I think a very relevant agenda. So let me conclude. Foreign investment is a very independent, a very important driver for economic development. So there is no doubt that discussions on international investment frameworks are extremely relevant for developed countries, developing countries, and LDCs. And we really have to find a balance between investors' interest and the interest of a host country. And we should explore avenues for multilateral discussions, approaches on investment regimes. And it's very important that we keep the confidence also of the developing countries in this global discussion. So as I started, all investment policies we must design with investors and host states both in mind. And at the end of all this, you can surely see investment can benefit both you and me. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your keynote. And now we're going to move straight to the panel. We will start with Dr. James Sand. James, as the editor-in-chief of the World Investment Report, and probably the most knowledgeable person in the world on investment stats, I would like to ask you a little bit about the state of affairs. Jonathan Free, the Canada ambassador, said at our TDS meeting 2 days ago that trade growth no longer outputs GDP growth, so we need to bring investment into the mix. So is that true? Are cross-border investment flows actually diminishing? And what are the recent FDI trends? So we've been talking about services, liberalization, and what role sell.
Thank you very much, Christian. Thank you for inviting me here to this important event. Thanks to ICTSD and also WEF. I recognize that the important audience here, including a distinguished lawmaker from South Africa, she has been chairing the parliamentary committee going through various investment bills. I see the impact right away that to have the opportunity for dialogue. Christian, you just gave a historical perspective of investment rulemaking very comprehensively. I wish to talk about the current challenges and perhaps the way ahead. First, to answer your questions regarding the GDC and the trade, I think as you said, that Ambassador Johnson was right, and I fully agree with him. We have seen over the past year that the trade growth, the growth rate for trade, is now slower than global GDP growth, which hasn't happened for the last decade or decade and a half. But now it's happening, and there are two major reasons. Of course, one is the weak aggregate demand at global level, but the second important issue is exactly the investment. Because the multinational companies are reluctant to invest and to expand their integrated international production network, which is coined here as global value chain. So because of that, the trade growth is weak. So he's right, just to answer that question. Allow me just to give you my perspective about the current trend. I have three messages or salient features regarding global trends in investment flows and the policy making. The first is about global investment trends that is characterized by low level of productive sector investment and tectonic change in the landscape. The first, I would say that if you observe what has happened since the global financial crisis in 2008-2009, and the road to recovery of FDI is bumpy. There are years of increase and there are years of decline. For example, last year global FDI declined by 16%, and the current level of global FDI flows is at $1.2 trillion to $1.3 trillion, which is one third less than the level of 2007. So on the one hand, we see that the multinational companies are sitting on piles of cash. We calculate it's about $5 trillion, as much as that. It is twice as much as the cash piles that the multinationals had before the crisis years. So that showed something. On the other hand, they are not investing, they are not expanding their global value chain networks. That's due to three factors: the fragility of the global economy, the volatility of the markets, and uncertainty of the policy making process. So these are the major factors, of course, plus the problem of the geopolitics risks. We know the risks of geopolitics has been mounting. So these are the factors we see in that sense. But we have also seen that over the past few years, the share of developing countries' FDI flows to the global total has increased to 55%. And we have also seen that outflows from developing countries are now account for over one third of the total outflows. So that shows developing countries are really, really advancing well in attracting investment and also in investing outward. Interestingly, we see that the outward investment from developing countries are mainly in the other developing countries. That's about 75% of the total outward investment from developing countries. This relates to the theme of this section, which means the question is that it's the end of the North-South game. We see that developing countries have an important stake as host country, home country, as well as a host country. So we also see an important factor that it's a lack of investment in sustainable development sectors and in productive sectors. In a sense, we are running into a paradoxical situation. On the one hand, the leaders worldwide have adopted the 17 goals for sustainable development, and we calculate in order to achieve the goals by 2030, there's a lack of $2.5 trillion annually. And in the meantime, we see there's a reservoir of cashes, financial assets. It's about $120 trillion. And even as I mentioned earlier, the cash holdings is about $5 trillion in the hands of the TNCs, but they are not investing. So that's the lack of investment in productive sector and in SDG sectors. Now, coming to the issue of policy trends, it is characterized by the fact that investment policy making is at a crossroads of paradigm shift. This paradigm shift from freedom of investment to investment for sustainable development. And first, we see the dichotomy of policy making at a national level, meaning if you look at the 20 years ago, the investment policy making, we see that 5% on average of the investment policies were in the territory of restriction and of the investment. That was 20 years ago, 10 years ago. Today we see that over 30%, between 30 and 35% of the new policy measures introduced in the territory of restricting and discouraging investment. Of course, we still see that the majority of the measures introduced are in the direction of promoting, liberalizing, and facilitating investment. But having said that, we see that the policymaking is at the level of the implementation. Or we see the level of investment protectionism is at the level of implementation. In a sense, we see the investment protectionism is mounting in the process of reviewing, approving investment into the countries, and we see in the different sectors. Of course, they are not all measures of investment protectionism. There are also legitimate measures in terms of protecting the policy space, national security issues that are fully understandable. But the key challenge is that there's no definition of protectionism. There's no such a definition. So there's no standards to judge whether certain policy measures are protectionist in nature or is legitimate to protect the key public interests of the countries. There are other challenges in the policymaking process. For example, the investment regime, which is multi-layered, multifaceted, highly fragmented, consists of 3,280 plus investment treaties, plus 3,880 double taxation treaties, because double taxation treaties are essential, also investment treaties, protecting investment, encouraging investment, and they are all. And these treaties are also highly fragmented and full of inconsistencies and problems. That taxation treaties inconsistency with investment treaties, there's cross kind of arbitration cases, and there are also issues of the consistency and coherence between investment treaties on the one hand and taxation treaties, competition policies, trade policies, on the other hand, environmental social standards also. So that's one challenge we're faced with, and that's what Martin mentioned, that UNCTAD has come up with an action manual for the reform of the international investment regime. So we need to fix the cars we have. In the meantime, we know that the investment treaty making pace is still going very rapidly. At the moment, over 100 countries are involved in negotiating investment treaties at bilateral and regional levels, over 100. So there's danger of the parallelism. We see the new treaties always saying, including TPP, saying that we go for parallelism. We still maintain the bilateral investment treaties. So if that's the case, we calculate with the ongoing 6 mega regional treaties that are being negotiated, that will be redundant with over 140 bilateral investment treaties that will continue to exist. So this kind of a multi-layer, multifaceted challenge is still there. There's also, of course, the legitimacy of the existing arbitrary system, investor-state dispute, that needs to be reformed. And there are, according to our statistics, about 608 cases, known cases, we have registered. The other issues that we need to shift from old generation of investment treaties to the new ones, we call the new generation of investment policies. And I stop here, I'm just highlighting the challenges.
Now we move on to George's view from the social issue, the Trade Union Confederation. We just wrapped up the fantastic conference with the party. Climate change with a fundamental, I think, role from grassroots organizations, unions, et cetera, in achieving success. How do you see from the social side the current investment regime and does it address really the present social and environmental issues?
Well, we believe that the current FDI regime does not really fully address labor and environmental concerns. A recent ITUC study survey in G7 countries shows that 75% of citizens do not trust corporations for all the stated reasons above. But there's something more on this. Citizens are losing trust to governments. In fact, the OECD conference, OECD Forum in 2013, was organized under this very topic, trust in governments. And corporate takeover of political power is scary, and it is happening. As last point, I mentioned that the UNCTAD Trade and Development Report in 2014 showed the limitations of FDI attracting policies, impact on national development, because they find that many countries are becoming locked into low added value activities, and they effectively lose all means to climb up the value adding scale, which is necessary in order to create this award. What we need here is industrial policies, but policy space is shrinking or is being diminished through signing big ideas and FTAs, or certainly the more modern 21st century, as they're called. Now, what is the alternative to that? Definitely obligatory due diligence across the supply chain, and this is certainly easier to happen with FDI, because with FDI, the lead firm and the subsidiary have many more business links than the way it's happening with outsourcing. For this, we need new international institutions, once an instrument, ones that can be modernized, but also we need new ones in order to, you know, have new global instruments for the global economy, because many of the instruments we have are still done on the national level. Competition authorities need to be strengthened and use their mandate more strictly when it comes to mergers and acquisitions. ISDS needs to be abolished. All BITs, we are calling as International Trade Union Movement, all BITs with ISDS need to be abolished. And the International Trade Union Movement and the civil society is going to stand with any government, especially the developing South, that is taking such a decision. I saw the surprise in the eyes of the member of the parliament from South Africa that we have here when you heard that the European Commission got 150,000 replies when they opened the consultation. And you might be surprised to know that 98% of that was actually against any form of ISDS. ISDS cannot be improved. It's an issue of unequal access to justice. So it needs to be abolished altogether. We also need a modernized global taxation regime to be put in place so that governments can again start having revenues. And I've heard from Mr. Van den Berg about the local content requirements. Very glad to hear that. Indeed, we need many more measures in order to increase the benefit that derives from FDI to the public and to the local economy. Thank you.
So much, George. I'm going to move right ahead with you in business now. Nicole, you were managed the folder of trade and investment of the largest world chamber of commerce. So maybe I'll follow up on your speakers and workers. What can business do to address this sustainable development concern? And then, of course, maybe if you can also tell us which venues this could be addressed. Start by
by saying ICC was started in 1919, and trade investment has been one of our core issues since the beginning. We first promulgated the guidelines on international investment in 1949. These were updated in 1972, and in 2012, we updated them again and launched them with the World Investment Forum in Doha with the aid of James and his team. And in these chapters, you may see that we do go further in the areas of environment, labor, and corporate social responsibility, and even the 2012 one a bit. So coming back to that, what we need to really focus on, I think, James, we've talked a lot about this in the E15 group, is how to create a positive environment for sustainable investment. And that is really going to take a concerted effort on civil society, government, and the business sector to create shared value for all. Because, as James mentioned, there is a $2.5 trillion annual funding gap in realizing the SDGs. I don't think in this era of fiscal conservatism that funding is going to come from governments or civil society. It's the private sector that creates jobs and GDP growth. So in that sense, we need to move beyond the blame game and also move into an era of perhaps how do we reorient the current balance while allowing for protection of investor rights, also preserving a certain policy space for the rights of states to regulate under a legitimate public policy objectives of environment or public health. In that sense, I'd like to mention that we served as the coordinator for the Global Business Alliance for the post-2015 SDGs, and we've just released the third edition of our Business Charter for Sustainable Development at the UN headquarters this past June. And in that sense, what we are trying to do is we need to do a better job of communicating the concept of sustainable development to the business community and bringing that into their business models and into the triple bottom line, which would also increase sustainability, where companies seek to manage their financial, societal, and environmental risks, obligations, and opportunities. It should be noted that this is an umbrella term, and this also includes corporate social responsibility, environmental, and social governance concepts. While we do have this is a particular need at individual companies, and it's more of an accessible starting point to develop sustainable business strategies. We do think that this can be moved out into mainstream economy, and as we continue talking about the SDGs, this is something that we are moving forward in at the company level. Now, at the kind of 30,000 foot level, when we talk about the uncertainty of the policymaking process, I'll go back to how ICC is responding to this increased rebalancing effort the right to regulate versus investor protection. And I don't think that these are mutually exclusive, and ICC does not take this stand. But however, striking that correct balance between the rights and responsibilities among the various stakeholders will take a coordinated effort. So one of the challenges, and James has rightly indicated, there is a $5 trillion stockpile of available funds, but it's not happening. Why is that? Fragility. Stands. And it does go further than much of the 2012 model the IT of the United States. And so this is something that we are dialoguing with in several different venues. And one of those venues would be the B20. The B20 started in Seoul, I think, in 2010. And that was where we had trade and investment within one work stream. That went up until Los Cabos in 2012, where they separated out trade and moved investment into investment and infrastructure. And unfortunately, what we saw was that infrastructure became, while it is a necessary topic, it was somewhat investment policy writ large was somewhat subsumed under that. So moving into the Chinese cycle in 2016, what we do see is that trade and investment will be recoupled together into one task force, which is something that ICC is very much in favor of, given the trade and investment nexus, of which we all understand at this point, I think. One of the things that ICC has been pushing through these various cycles of the G20 presidencies is towards an eventual multilateralization of investment, towards a multilateral framework on investment. This is a very much a long-term goal. We don't think it will happen overnight, nor is it necessarily a right moment for this to happen. However, given the fact that with the over 3,200 bilateral investment treaties and investment chapters within the trade agreements, coupled with the over 3,000 double taxation treaties, these only cover about two-thirds of all investor
relationships. UNCTAD has estimated that it would take another 14,000 to cover all relationships. From a business perspective, that's not a viable solution. We are looking at the chapters coming out of the mega regionals. We do understand that this is going to be a multi-layer effect and very multifaceted. You're going to have your national, bilateral, regional, and hopefully multilateral effect of treaties. So this is something that we're working on. We're bringing it forward, and I'd be happy to answer any questions moving forward.
Thank you very much, Nicole. What we'll do now is we'll move to our last two speakers, and we'll ask them to come in the capacity of discussants, to take what has been said on the table and maybe give a few remarks before we go to some follow-up questions and questions from the audience. And first, we'll go with Ana Escobedo. Ana, ArcelorMittal, I believe that the world's largest steel producer, and going back into this North-South game depiction, definitely a company coming from the South side as a foreign investor, both in developing and developed countries. What's your take on both the conversations and if this investment trees actually work for you?
Thank you very much, Christian. First of all, I would like to thank the panelists on the ICTSD and the World Economic Forum for this opportunity to talk to everybody. Maybe I would like to first give a bit of a framework so you understand how a company such as ArcelorMittal or the steel sector analyze this situation. A company that depends on a heavy investment to get into a country, it is more concerned about how it's going to operate in that country. It does not look at exit strategy because we look more on a long-term partnership. And when I say these, I'm talking on the steel side as well as the mining side. We are there mostly to stay. So the relationship with the government is a key priority, but the most priority is also that we can collaborate with the communities. This brings me to how do we see the investment agreements and how are they considered when we invest in a country. Investment agreements for us is kind of a tool to break entry barriers. But on the steel sector or similar sectors, the entry barriers have different forms. And some of these forms are not or cannot be addressed by an investment bilateral agreement or a regulatory agreement. I'm going to give you some examples so you can understand what I'm saying. You may know that China is the biggest steel producer in the world. They're also the biggest steel consumer in the world. historically, the steel sector has been a very important part of their economy. So they had these investment rules saying that no foreign investment could be linked to a majority shareholder of a steel company. So that was a very clear ruling. When the demand of Chinese grew, certainly was a very key driver for companies like ArcelorMittal, for private sector, to look at the opportunities to invest in China. So we thought, oh, a bilateral investment treaty with China will help us. That takes a long time to achieve. The market did its play, and China had the need to look for foreign investment because the state could not afford anymore the losses of the steel making. So they open in a very, let's say, random way the door to foreign investment, which now is probably not the time to invest in China. They have, they own 300 million tons excess capacity. So, and they have very, let's say, regulatory frame for their own producers. A second example, it's India. India is one of the only countries that is growing on the demand of steel sector. And they do not have a direct block on investment, foreign direct investment in India. The problem is that they have so many other regulations that do foreign direct investment in India is almost impossible on the steel sector. So would an investment treaty help us to get into India? I don't know. Then we have a third, probably extreme actor country, Iran. Back in 2003, before the sanctions implemented, sorry, 2002, before the sanctions, Iran was one of the growing markets for steel consumption. And a good portion of imports was targeted to Iran. When the sanctions came, I don't know, the magic was adapted, and from being net importers, they are now net exporters, and they are pushing their exports worldwide. So would now an investment treaty would work with Iran? I don't know. What I'm trying to say here is our investment, let's say, approach is based in basically 2 points. Market access and cost competitive advantage. So we either invest in a country to cover the domestic production and export from there, or we see a country to trade. So our relationship of investment and trade is very much defining where we are going to invest. Which brings me to what is the real regulation that makes us invest in a country? And this is a program that one of my colleagues in the panel said, industrial policy, or the programs for internal policy. We do depend on cost competitiveness. I'm going to tell you a story. Oops, I passed. When 50 years ago, Europe was the biggest hub for, apart from China, for steel production. Times have changed. We were net exporters, and we had targeted. The South has developed their steel production. Now they are producers of steel. So countries like, regions like Europe have to reassess the investment strategy, the steel sector, the investment strategy, because we do not have the demand in Europe that can sustain the domestic production and absorb the increased imports, while the other countries, emerging countries, are growing their domestic production. So this is a question that comes back to my point. Our investment decision is pretty much on how much cost competitive we could be. I'm going to stop there. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anna. We now move ahead to the last of our speakers, and Moses, coming from the Investment Promotion Authority angle, I think we just heard actually from someone on the ground at foreign investors, and now you actually manage the foreign investment into the country. So your takes on this, do the investment treaties actually work effectively, and do this, maybe a follow-up on that, do you hope for regional integration frameworks to actually work for you? Because we're talking about mega-regionals here at the continental free trade area will be coming soon for Africa, hopefully.
Thank you very much, Christian, and the ICTSD with the WEF for organizing this. I'll make my comments on about three areas. One is brief about Kenya, very briefly. First to say, we recognize the importance of FDI as a country. Actually, our development blueprint, the transformative blueprint we are pursuing since 2008, is called Kenya Vision 2030, is quite strongly hinged upon strong investment, both domestic and foreign. In fact, we calculated that to be able to get a double-digit economic growth rate, we need the investment as a share of GDP to get to at least 32%. This is both public investment and private investment. And so my work is try and see that we are getting to that level as quickly as possible. Second thing is to say Kenya has under a very strong legal framework, and I think the comment made by maybe the Director General, that BITs possibly work maybe where the law is not that strong, where the law is weak. Because Kenya from 1964, after getting independence, has enacted the Foreign Investment Protection Act. And so there has been a very strong law, predictable framework all this time. Let me also say, right now Kenya has 12 BITs that have been active, and five more are almost getting to being gazetted. So I think we see they are quite important from that. And 16, avoidance of double taxation agreements. So now the second point I would like to say is, do BITs work? When Anna spoke, I actually completely, what you've observed was more in line with what she said. Because, first of all, I was actually surprised by the research from the Netherlands that shows that a percent that BITs actually contribute to about 30% of growth in bilateral FDI, because some other research seems to suggest that BITs are not having an impact. So I think this is one thing I would like maybe to later on we can discuss and see whether we need more research so that we can actually, through evidence, put this baby to bed. On that. What we've seen when investors come, they are primarily first concerned about fundamentals. I think that's what Anna said. What is the bottom line? If I come to Kenya, where is the market? Where are the opportunities? What kind of return can I get? That is the first thing investors ask. And my job involves meeting a lot of delegations. The second issue they ask is, investment, do I have the investment opportunity I'm looking for? If I'm in energy sector, which opportunities are available? Do they give opportunity for a scale? Can I do a big project? They also look at incentives and the business environment. How strong is the private sector? Do you have unique incentives, either tax or others? When they are satisfied with this is when they start now looking at other issues about, do we have an IPPA with your country and things like that. So what I'm saying, I wouldn't say they don't work. I would say it's something that still needs to be looked at. Obviously, they have a concern, and especially when there's uncertainty, investors take this much more seriously. But I would also say they are also important from the side of policy certainty, because policy certainty is one of the key things that investors consider as part of their bottom line. They want to be sure to know that they can predict what will happen maybe a few months to come and the following year. The third area I would like to mention on is that, especially with comments from Georgios. He talked about, quite very strongly, maybe doing away with the international system of dispute resolution and other. What I would say, of course, even though there are, of course, concerns about the quality of investment, that's going to developing countries and elsewhere. You hear people sometimes saying investors are coming and doing simple tasks that could be done by the local people and all these kind of things about the quality of jobs created. But I think that should not be enough to actually think that having a proper systems or tools is not a good thing. We have an option to use, let's say, conditional incentives to be able to achieve sustainable development. For instance, I think in Kenya now we are developing a national investment policy, and we are saying this is a chance where we can design conditional incentives and say rather than everybody, every investor gets this kind of incentive, you say your incentive is equivalent to the impact you create on employment, on the quality of the environment, on other areas, maybe even a distribution of investment within the country for equity, all those considerations. So I think I'll stop there.
Thank you so much. A fascinating discussion, really, and I see it's been going on two tracks. One of them, it's about the policy and the need for reform. I think the opportunities for reform, and Martin, Nicole, I think that touch, and James definitely touch upon that. And then the second part of the discussion, which was really are these PITs or investment framework really working? And of course, that discussion is not new. It's been going on for a long, long time. So what I'll try to do in the next, and I'll ask you maybe just try to ask one question and ask your opinion in a minute and a half maximum, is to try to reconcile that discussion. And maybe Nicole, starting with you, you the ICC, of course, operate one of the main central venues for investment dispute settlement, which is the International Chamber of the Court of the ICC. A view on ISDS, maybe in a minute, not a minute and a half.
Thank you. We've talked about investor-state dispute settlement quite a bit within our various working bodies at the International Chamber of Commerce. One of our main bodies, which is not the policy advocacy track, is the ICC Court of Arbitration. And the court was founded in 1923, and it administers over 23,000 cases. Of those, not that many deal with states or state entities. Of most of I think it's about 10% are states and state entities, and those are based off of contractual claims. Only 18% of that 10% are under BITs, or investment chapters within free trade agreements. However, there have been increasing amounts of investor-state dispute settlement cases and to reflect the need for us to better administer those, we undertook a revision of the rules of arbitration. And those rules actually increase on transparency and confidentiality. We also, within the court, have dealt with the consultation group on TTIP. This was an interesting process whereby we have national chapters which are very much geared towards promotion and protection of investor rights. However, because the court is primarily a center for justice, we had to take a more nuanced approach to our consultation answer. This is publicly available online, and we do actually take a lot of discussion with the transparency and confidentiality proposals. With respects to the appellate mechanism and consistency of rulings, the EU proposal for an appellate mechanism on TTIP intends to respond to a lot of the concerns of the inconsistency of awards rendered and in investment treaty arbitration and the criticism about ISDS writ large. There has been an unprecedented increase in the annulment and set-aside procedures and in investment treaty arbitration, either initiated by the party to be reined in and a more recent surge, again, in challenging the arbitral awards rendered in investment treaty arbitration. We think that, however, that the appellate mechanism in TTIP would nevertheless introduce a major change in investment arbitration as it is currently designed and functioning. And in doing so, the proposal furthers the risk of fragmentation of international investment law and may deepen the divide between older generation BITs and modern FTAs. Therefore, ICC is not particularly in favor of establishing an appellate mechanism. However, should an appellate mechanism proceed, some additional comments can be made. We would suggest discussion of an appellate mechanism should not be carried out only between the EU and the US in the context of TTIP, without taking into account its effects on the system of IIAs writ large as it applies to thousands of existing treaties. And we would also state that it would be important to have an inclusive global debate take place. And we would be happy to participate in this. And we do look at the UNCITRAL revision on transparency as a very good model in which to move forward.
Martin, what next now? I mean, we've heard about some questions on the way forward that the EU has proposed. We're hearing, you know, how much do we actually can use these agreements? If we try to getting into sort of an E15 mindset, now, if we try to look a little bit forward, a couple of years, maybe not immediately, how do we fix this? How do we create this proposal that the EU or something multilateral or plurilateral? What's going to happen?
Good question, not so easy to answer. But I think what we all agree on is that, well, first of all, I think what James also said, we see that, and it's really upset, it's the end of the North. Investment, you see, is really a global issue. You see investment from LDCs to developing countries, vice versa, from developed countries to LDCs. So it's not only, as I earlier said, an OECD picture. It's really, and it's relevant for all the countries. So FDI is extremely relevant. Sustainability of FDI, responsible business, all those issues are extremely relevant. And there is, we also see a huge concern on investment regimes. On the bilateral level, we had discussions earlier on the multilateral level. So I think at least we all agree we do need a discussion of the investment regimes. So as I said, that's another question of do we need it, but how are we going to organize it? And at the same time, if I discuss with many countries, also many developing countries, like South Africa, for example, yesterday we had a discussion with the minister, there is a big, there's not a lot of confidence among many countries that we really have an open dialogue and discussion on investment regimes, which partly I can understand. Also, if you look, for example, the trade discussions, I can understand frustration or lack of confidence on among developing countries. Nevertheless, I think the issue is so crucial and important because, as I said, and others also said, we do really need investment, also from the private sector. Private investment extremely relevant and needed, also for the SDGs. So we are asking ourselves, how can we start a kind of a confidence-building process? I mean, if you don't have confidence, I don't think we can move forward. So we really need to start a confidence-building, open-mind dialogue on how we can move forward on the investment regulation issue. And I agree with the private sector. If we have so many different bits, the fragmentations, the inefficiencies, the lack of transparency, consistency, so I think it's really time to find a kind of a way, avenues for multilateral approaches, discussions, so we really can have a multilateral discussion on this. In the end, everybody will win on this, but I agree, very complicated. But I think that's good that we have the work of UNCTAD, of the WEF, of the E15 process, because that can help to build up confidence, but also to build the agenda. What kind of issues do we have to discuss in that agenda to have a kind of architecture of the process and the agenda? I think extremely relevant.
Thank you very much. And from the E15 side, we really welcome your comments because, as you're aware, we'll be outputting the results of the E15 in Davos. And one of the main proposals of the E15 investment task force is going to be to build this confidence building process within maybe, you know, support of universities, or we have to find the right venue. But I think that this is definitely one of the messages that the E15 wants to send to the international community. Georgios, maybe in a minute each, if I can ask, we're talking about building a confidence, this confidence building process, then where is it going to happen? What are the right venues to go here? And maybe, if I can add, is the WTO the place, considering that we're here at MCM10?
I think we are careful on using the word. Confidence building, consensus building is one. Rulemaking is another.
Totally. So I went for the softer one.
I heard what Martin said, and you said in terms of what we mean. In terms of consensus building, I think it can be multi-layered and multifaceted at all levels, and it has been happening. What we, including the E15, which is a very good initiative, and is now yielding very fruitful results, and it's impactful. In terms of building consensus and confidence, we've been doing it at many levels. And the weak part is multilateral level of consensus building or confidence building. And for that, I think there's no controversy that we need that process. The case we have is the recent outcome of the Accra Action Agenda, not Accra, the Addis Ababa Action Agenda. In that, there's a paragraph 92. It says that's basically endorsed by all the member states of the UN, saying that there's a need for improvement of the existing international investment regime, and called up on UNCTAD to provide a platform to facilitate consultations among the member states towards that direction. And that's a clear mandate and this consensus at the multilateral level. So there's a need for that, and UNCTAD has been doing that. But UNCTAD cannot be alone on that, and there are many other forums and the initiatives, and I recognize the ICTSD and the WEF initiative. Now, I just wish to say a few things more about the approach in terms of the international investment regime.
Please.
Which is highly fragmented. Now, Giorgio mentioned that we don't need this system, we need to abolish that. Well, we also heard that Martin and Nicole said, well, it is useful for promoting investment. The UNCTAD position is this. We know that the current regime is full of problems, but to abolish it, is it feasible? We're talking about a feasibility. What is the current trend? The current trend is that we see a number of countries trying to disengage from the system, denouncing the bids that include South Africa, Indonesia, and some other countries that they do not go public, but they are doing that. That I know the names. If they don't want to go public, I won't name them. There are also a number of countries going for upscaling. As you've seen this TPP, they are upscaling their standards, going for the highest. And they're also at the bilateral level, we see that, like some ASEAN countries, Southeast Asian countries, and East Asian countries, and including some Arab states, they continue the current regime. They continue the current model bids. And then we see a large number of them, over 70 countries, have been reviewing, revising their model bids, or in the process of doing so. So they are going to different directions. But even for South Africa, for Indonesia, we see they are not closing the door of saying that we abandon the approach. They are saying that it depends on the future economic reality and needs. So I'm talking about the feasibility. Now, the way out is reform. So that's why, at the request of the member states, that we came up with an action manual for reform. As Martin already said earlier in his keynote, that is not a question of to reform or not, but how and to what extent. And we outline five priority areas. First is the SDG-oriented, sustainable development-oriented. We know through our surveys that 80% of the treaties do not have provisions on sustainable development or all kind of the notion in the preamble that we need a sustainable development notion. And second is to balance the rights and obligations, to strengthen the right to regulate for the public policies. The third is the systemic issues we need to address for coherence, consistencies, and the fourth one is ISDS, that we need the reform to make the sustainable development friendly and to make it effective and more legitimate. And the last is the corporate social responsibilities that is needed in this area. I mean, even Nicole mentioned the guidelines of ICC. The business world also recognized the importance of corporate responsibilities. I think there's consensus. What I wish to say is that there's a need, perhaps at this stage, a consensus on the guiding principles for formulating 21st century investment policies. It's a long way to go for formulating the rules of investment at a multilateral level, but to have a consensus on a set of guiding principles in formulating investment policies at national, regional, and the multilateral level is desirable. Thank you.
Thank you, James. Georgios, I'll put it very simply, is that so? Your comments, and if you could address the chances for the WTO to be also helped for this.
Sure, just let me start by saying that feasibility is a matter of political will. If governments want it, they can change the system, they can abolish the ISDS. I'm not saying that there should be no investment protection, but why shouldn't that be on a state-to-state level? State-to-state dispute element, like it is, for example, on commercial disputes in the WTO today. And let's start with the national court. Why shouldn't companies or any other individuals address themselves first to the national system of justice? There is the issue here of the individual against state. The only other mechanism against, except the ISDS that I know, where individuals are given the right to take governments to the court is the European Court of Human Rights. But it's all individuals. It's a homosexual worker that got fired when they learned that he was homosexual, so he got discriminated, has the right, after exhausting all national means of remedy, of to then go to the European Court of Human Rights. As also there have been many cases of expropriation of property, and property rights are human rights, but the idea of investors' rights is very vague. It has been created quite recently. So property rights and people who get their property expropriated also have the right to go to this court, and they have indeed gone to this court before. So if we are to have a state a dispute settlement that is giving the individual the right to take a state to a court of whatever sort or a tribunal, let us have that all. And on where this investment, whether should it be a WTO issue, well, there is a certain advantage there, that indeed developing countries, just because in the WTO it's multilateral, they're all together, they will have the bargaining power, a better bargaining power to negotiate something better on investment. But on the current situation, where we have more than 3,600 BITs, most of them with ISDS, taking investment in the WTO to create another ISDS or, on top of the already existing ISDS, a state-to-state dispute settlement, I think is an exaggeration. How much more would the governments agree to get rid of themselves and give themselves into investors? So if there was a guarantee that all BITs go extinct at the moment that a plurilateral or multilateral agreement in the WTO on investment is agreed, I think that would be a better idea, but there's no guarantees for this at the moment. Let me also remind that the BITs, how many people, I want to ask a question, how many of you have actually read any BIT? Please raise hands. Quite many, but it's still though about one third of the people in the room. Well, it's about 12, many of these models are 12 pages long. out of 12 pages, the 11 pages are talking only about ISDS. I'm calling you to read also the Brazilian model. Brazil is a country that has never signed any BAT or ratified, actually, any BAT with ISDS, and it's arguably a country that attracts investment. And they have a model that is talking more about trade, like investment facilitation, investment promotion, so how authorities like the one that Moses is working in can cooperate together in order to create this enabling environment that we all want for investment to do create jobs and create sustainable development.
James, 20 seconds that you asked me for.
Right. It's not totally disagree with what George has said. It's just to remind the complexity of the issue. In most of the BITs, almost all of them, they have the state-to-state dispute settlement mechanism. It's not that they don't have. But the issue is that we analyze the pros and cons of both investor-state and state-to-state. They both have the pros and the cons. And perhaps you may wish to read, not you, I'm just talking, the participant to read our analysis. Now, we have three options, not just the two, not just to have or not to have the BITs. It's basically to continue with the current model of the BITs or to have a new generation of BITs. I mean, I would count the Brazilian model is a new generation, it's part of a new generation of BITs. So basically, do we need a new generation of BITs that focus on sustainable development orientation? And the third one is no BITs or no rules.
Yeah.
So there are three options. Which is optimal? That's the question. Not just to have or not to have now. And there's a feasibility issue. Thanks.
Let me thank you. And perhaps before I'm going to give the opportunity for final words from our two discussants at the end and our keynote speaker. But before, let me go to the audience and see if we can gather a few questions. Maybe I'll take three of them. We have, I think, around, started a bit late, so around 10 to 12 minutes until the finish of the panel. Sir, if we can just provide a microphone.
Thank you very much. My name is Arya, I'm from Indonesia. And it's been this panel is actually, for me, it's one of the most interesting ones I've been attending since the very first day I've been in TDS. On a more broader and general level, there has been some group of countries in the WTO has been trying to push the Singapore issues to go back to the WTO framework. While we already know that in 2004, the General Council already decided that those issues should not be dealt within the Doha framework. I don't know, maybe because they got trade facilitation in Bali, so they thought they can get the three remaining Singapore issues going forward. But first of all, if we talk about investment in the future, we'll be balancing what the host country and the investor, you know, rights and obligations. How do you balance that if you know that the United States Trade Representative already stated that the TPP investment model will be the model that they will be wish to see for the world to use, while Indonesia, Brazil, and India are taking a different approach? How do you bridge this in a multilateral? First, procedurally, you shouldn't do that. Mm-hmm. Second, substantively, it will be very hard. And talking more about the substantive, if private sector thinks that they need to bring sustainable development into their business model, and with this is why they need investment, well, I don't want to sound pessimistic, but there is a narrative like some group of countries want to push SMEs and GVCs because they want competition policy, and maybe they want to push SDGs and investment because they want investment in the WTO. But there is this kind of, you know, some sort of a bad, you know, bad tone in the negotiation itself. Why do you use SDGs? But if you want to brings SDGs into the business model, why can't actually private sector or investors also bring political risk in their business model? Why do you need ISDS? Isn't it, before you bring SDGs, you should also include political risk in your business model? It's not that we need investment, you also need to invest your money somewhere. Yeah. So I want each panelist to really think about these basic ideas of this, including the procedural problem in the WTO. Thank you.
Thank you. If we could get another, please. If we get another brief question, please.
Sure. Okay. Thank you for the fascinating presentations. There was some discussion about how far BEETs have been helpful in attracting FDI. Do we have enough evidence or some evidence that looks at how far ISDS in particular has helped in attracting FDI? That is a question to the entire panel. The second one is, when we are talking about reforming ISDS, Martin, you mentioned about the EU model. I'd like to hear from you a little bit more on how far this EU model is different from the ISDS and how far it is replicable, say, in a developing country. And my very short question to Anna, you were mentioning about cost competitiveness as a major determining factor of your investment. You know, in the context of climate change, we discuss about this issue of carbon leakage. You know that, to what extent difference in climate-related regulations or requirements would be a determining factor for relocation decisions. I would like to hear from you in the steel sector, in the mining sector, to what extent do you think those kinds of environmental or, in particular, climate-related regulations would be a determining factor in your investment decision? Thank you.
Thank you. Perhaps we'll take one more short question. Sure. Please. A single question, so shoot your bullet well.
Thank you. Because Dr. mentioned there is a fundamental shift from freedom of investment to investment for sustainable development. Mm-hmm. I want to know how this is implemented and enforced in IRAs and also by dispute settlement panels. And in particular in the because in dispute settlement systems, the investors and the state, they appoint arbitrators. They can appoint arbitrators. And the arbitrators, they are independent. They are either professors or lawyers in the law firm. There is no institutions which commit to sustainable development to govern the arbitrators. And a lot of arbitrators are appointed mainly because they tend to favor investors. And how would you can address this concern? Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe Martin, if we can start with you on the question of the new model on ISDS.
Yeah, thank you, Christian. Maybe a few remarks on the questions. I think they're all very relevant questions, but need more time to answer. Maybe one remark on the effectiveness of ISDS or effectiveness of BITs, what we see, and there's always discussions whether they're effective or not, and I think of course a company invests because on the one hand of opportunities, but of course they always do a risk analysis as well, and in part of their risk analysis of course is also the political risk, but also how their investments are protected in a particular country, and in that respect what we see is that a bit can very much helpful to give some confidence to the investor. And if we see to the studies what we have done ourselves, we see really an impact of bids on FDI stock. So we always can discuss studies, but that's what we see in our study. On the new model, it's, need more time to be very detailed, but the difference, of course, is a model of arbitration to a model of lawyers, to a kind of a court system. I think it's a big change, a fundamental change, what the EU has proposed in the TTIP discussions. So it really improves transparency. You have a fixed list of arbitrators or judges, or however you call them. So I think it's a very major change. We had already, personally I had, but it was really on a personal basis, discussions with some developing countries. they are very open for the ICS kind of discussion, so I think it's an interesting debate also with developing countries. Also, the EU is already discussing this with their partners like Vietnam and so. So there's, I think, plenty of room also for developing countries in the ICS discussion.
Thank you. Maybe I'll stay with you, Martin, for last question on how do you bridge these models? Because I think, of course, we haven't talked about other models such as Indonesia, South Africa, Brazil, et cetera, and of course, very different than what's been tabled at the mega regional. So perhaps linked to the place at WTO, or what would be your view? view to bridge these models?
How to bridge these models? Yeah, that's complicated. So one of the people in the audience said the TPP model will be the model, what the Americans said. Well, the TPP model is not a TTIP model. So we have already a discussion with the United States. And I think the EU is very strong in its position of the investment court. So how do we bridge it? Well, as was earlier said, we need to reform. We are already reforming. What James said, we are looking to a new kind of bids. Look to the CETA. The ISDS model in CETA is already different from the old bids. So we are already reforming within the bids on ISDS. And I think we need to have the discussion on, if we want to go to a more multilateral approach, explore multilateral avenues and have the discussions on the issues also James mentioned and I mentioned myself in my speech, to discuss issues like, how to move forward with ISDS, but also with sustainability, transparency, issues mentioned are extremely relevant. But of course, we see very diverse interests and diverse positions. So that won't be easy at all. But if we are so much connected through global or regional value chains, I think it's very good to at least explore multilateral approaches, also from a public interest, and to look for public values and public goals. It's good to have that kind of discussion, and maybe we can make some progress in a multilateral approach.
Thank you. James, if we can in 30 seconds, I think a question that on the how do we actually have enough evidence of if IFDS have helped attracting FDI? What has been your measurements of that?
That I think almost for all the events discussing the investment treaties, this question comes up.
So you're prepared.
And I have a brief comprehensive answer to that. We have done a comprehensive study last year. It's a survey of all of the literature for all the empirical studies, and then we summarize on that. Let's see first. It depends on the type of investment treaties. You have the model of including the pre-establishment that contains liberalization. For the time being, there are over 200 such bilateral investment treaties and regional treaties that contain the pre-establishment, meaning market access for investment. For that type of treaties, yes, it has direct impact on investment flows into the countries because it liberalizes the sectors. But the majority of the treaties are protection treaties in nature. And then it doesn't have the direct effect, or the effect is not that, it's difficult to link. It's partly because investment flows depends on a whole set of determinants, and this investment treaty is only one of 100, for example. But it has a role that people call it, that the investment treaty is like a lifeboat on the cruise. In case you want to use it, you use it. So that's the perception I think some business have been saying all the time. Now, having said that, there's also the problem of the treaties. If you look at all those treaties called investment promotion and protection treaties, in fact, they are only protection provisions. Over 80% of the investment treaties do not have provisions on promoting and facilitating investment. That part is missing. Of course, that's part of the aspect we wish to advocate for reform, meaning we need the component of investment promotion facilitation linking to, this link is very important, to sustainable development goals. So if we have that part in place, then the traction of the treaties may be more effective. So that's what I just wish to say about that.
Thank you. I think we left one or two questions and response would please do approach the panelists at the end and we can have a broader conversation. But before wrapping it up, what I would like to do is give our two discussants the word for 1 or 2 minutes. I think, Anna, you actually got a question on carbon leakage that you can address, and please then a couple of takeaways, and then I will ask Moses to give us his final impressions on the session before we wrap up.
Sure, thank you. Thank you for the question. I think the results of COP21, we see it as a time bomb. Why? Imagine if a country decides to exempt some sectors on measures and put all the carbon reduction on the other sectors, while the developed countries decide to be very strict? What is going to happen? We will not be able to compete. So our concern is, if there's not an alignment or at least an understanding of the government, that there has to be a responsibility sharing. The problem with the steel industry is we are in the supply chain. If suddenly a government says, we are going to clean this country, all the steel is out, well, who's going to build your photovoltaic plant? Who's going to build your wind power plant? What are you going to use? Trees? You do need steel. So we hope that there is an understanding and we can work with the government. So to share this, if we are in a position to pass the price or the cost of this of being a clean supply chain, which is that has to be the concept, we need to stop addressing industries by itself. It's a supply chain. Solutions are supply chain. The user has to be responsible. If we are going to change from fossil fuel to renewable energy, there has a supply chain behind renewable energy. So our hope is that countries that take very strict measures on climate change, they share the burden, and they do a more rational and logical coordination of industrial policies that allows the industry like us, that we are key in the supply chain for the sustainable future, to share the burden with the government, with the user. For us, that's the only key that we're going to survive. Otherwise, let the Chinese produce all the steel and all the CO2, and then we depend on what they want to do. I don't think that's the future.
Moses, to finalize, to have the final word in the panel, I think you've heard a broad thing. This is not the average panel in which you sit in, which is more tending to investment promotion, rather this broad discussion on policy, on ways forward, on big treaties, you know, that are going to regulate the investment flows going forward. What's your take? How much does it matter to you, and how does it change your life going forward as an investment promotion authority and as a manager of FDI in the country?
Yeah, thank you very much. First is again to basically say the importance of FDI is really not questionable. We found, if I just give very quickly an example of a company like Safaricom in Kenya, which has so far created about close to 400,000 outlets that are employing a number of people to distribute airtime and the M-Pesa financial, you know, mobile money transfer. You can see the kind of impact. It has also made Kenya, the Brookings Institution, find Kenya recently in a standard as number one in terms of financial inclusion, largely because of what this investment has created. So it's very crucial. Secondly, is to be able to, I agree, we need to have a multilateral arrangements. Anything that can be able to fast track and streamline the flow of investment is welcome. But of course, we need to be able to take one step back and say, how have the existing multilateral platforms performed? So that, like the colleague from Indonesia said, we don't want maybe a system where 100 positions, nothing is moving, you know? So we need, I think it's good to be able to say, really look at what is existing and see what can be made different so that we don't get obstacles on the way. I think I'll stop there. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, and before wrapping up, I will just commend you to keep tuned into the E15 initiative. We didn't touch upon the work on investment policy that we do at the E15 because we're launching our policy recommendations in Davos later next year, but we have here at the table actually three of these experts that are crafting those recommendations, Nicole Grignard and James Shan and Anna Escobedo. We'll be outputting not only a set of policy recommendations for countries, business, and civil society, but also around 20 white papers addressing very specific issues on recommendations on investment. So please, on our website and future events, keep tuned to the A15 initiative. With that, I will please ask you to give a big round of applause to our speakers and keep